busy operating as usual.
Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to the first Indo-Sri Lankan webinar on meniscus repair. And we have with us the president of the Sri Lankan Orthopedic Association, Dr. Velayutham Swarnakumar. He is a senior consultant orthopedic surgeon attached to National Hospital of Sri Lanka, Colombo. His special interest is in arthroscopy, arthroplasty, and limb reconstruction, and also spinal deformity correction. He has been the president of the Sri Lanka Society for Surgery of the Hand as well. So I hand over to our moderator for today. Over to you, Dr. Velayutham Swarnakumar.
Good evening, and thank you for this kind introduction. And on behalf of Sri Lanka Orthopedic Association, we are very thankful to this Ortho TV setup for organizing this webinar, incorporating Sri Lankan faculty experts as well as Indian experts in arthroscopic work. So it's my great pleasure in involving this program as a coordinator, and so I am inviting all my faculties, and this is going to be our faculty. We are going to have from Sri Lanka, Dr. Dilshan Munidas and Dr. Chindak Vijayadas, and also from India, Dr. Sundara Rajan from Ganga Hospital, and Dr. Nilesh Kamat, and Dr. Atik Vasudev. So these are the faculty we are going to have presentations. So first I would like to invite Dr. Chindak Vijayadas. He is going to talk on meniscus anatomy and biomechanics. Dr. Chindak Vijayadas is an arthroscopic surgeon, mainly with interest in arthroscopy, and he spends a lot of time in short arthroscopy as well as knee arthroscopy. He is working in Navy Hospital in Sri Lanka and involved in many sports injuries, focusing mainly in knees and arthroplasties. And he's going to talk on meniscus anatomy and biomechanics. I invite Dr. Chindak Vijayadas for this podium to deliver your presentation. And we'll be continuing with this presentation, and in between we can include questions. And at the end of the program, we can have the panel discussion involving all faculty. So Dr. Chindak Vijayadas, it's over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Swarnakumar, for your kind introduction. And also I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to join this Zoom meeting. And today I'll be giving a brief introduction to meniscal anatomy and the biomechanics within the time allocated to me. Can you see the presentation?
No, not yet. We can see it.
Not yet.
You have to click on share screen.
Yeah, okay.
And then select your presentation and then double click it.
Can you see now?
Yes.
Yes, we can.
Okay, good. So brief introduction to the meniscal anatomy and the biomechanics. The menisci originally considered as vestigial structures. These are semilunar fibrocartilaginous discs. Their primary function is to transmit load. These menisci are critical for knee biomechanics, and removal of any of the menisci will have some deleterious effect to the joint. These menisci are pivotal in maintaining knee biomechanics, homeostasis, joint function, stability, and the longevity of the articular cartilage. Alternatively, there are novel regenerative treatments are being attempted to treat the meniscal injuries. the gross anatomy of the meniscus. They are crescentic fibrocartilages located in the medial and lateral knee compartments. They enable effective articulation. These structures enable effective articulation between the rounded femoral condyles and relatively flat tibial articular surface. Menisci are roughly triangular in their cross-section, and they cover 1/2 to 2/3 of the articular surface of the tibial plateau. This is an anatomical dissection of the tibial side of the knee joint to demonstrate the gross anatomy of the meniscal attachment site. The anterior horn of the medial meniscus can have a variable attachment. However, firm bony attachment to the flat intercondylar region of the tibial plateau is the commonest. The posterior horn of the medial meniscus attaches to the anterior to the insertion of the posterior cruciate ligament. In the lateral meniscus, the anterior horn inserts on the tibia in front of the intercondyle eminence, just posterior and lateral to the ACL attachment site, and we use this anatomical site in our ACL reconstruction to locate the tibial tunnel. The posterior horn of the lateral meniscus attaches to the tibia in between the insertion sites of the PCL and the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. The anatomy of the medial meniscus. The medial meniscus has an asymmetric C shape with a much wider posterior horn than an anterior horn. It's firmly attached to the joint capsule throughout its periphery and to the deep medial collateral ligament. This is a thickening of the joint capsule in its mid portion. Anterior horn is attached to the anterior horn attachment is the geographically largest attachment. Anatomy of the lateral meniscus. Lateral meniscus is semicircular in shape, and anterior and posterior horns are attached close to each other than compared to the medial meniscus. Anterior horn is attached adjacent to the ACL insertion. The posterior horn is attached anterior to both PCL insertion and the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. There are two important ligaments connecting posterior horn of the lateral meniscus to the medial femoral condyle. Ligament of Humphrey is located anterior to the posterior cruciate ligament, and ligament of Meesburg is attached posterior. Lateral meniscus is not continuously attached to the capsule as opposed to the medial meniscus due to the presence of a popliteal hiatus. The biochemical composition of the meniscus. The biochemical composition-wise, the meniscal tissue contains 72% of water out of its wet weight, and rest is the extracellular matrix. 75% of the extracellular matrix is composed of collagen and other components, which include glycosaminoglycan 17%, DNA 2%, adhesion glycoproteins, and elastin 1% each. The collagen distribution of collagen is different in the different zones of the meniscus. The red ridge zone of the meniscus contains about 80% of its dry weight of type 1 collagen. Other types are type 2, 3, 4, and 6. They comprise about 1% of the total collagen. The white ridge zone contains about 42% of type 1 collagen and about 20% of type 2 collagen. Next, about the extracellular matrix. What proteoglycans are a major component of extracellular matrix? These include chondroitin 6 sulfate, about 60%, dermatan sulfate, about 30%, and chondroitin 4 sulfate, about 20%. These glycoproteins enable meniscus to absorb water, and their distribution shows regional variation. About inner 2/3 containing more glycoproteins compared to the outer 1/3. The cells, vessels, and nerve supply to the meniscus. when we consider about the cells, there are three types of cells that can be identified in the meniscal tissue, namely chondrocyte-like cells, fibroblast-like cells, and intermediate cells. The cellular component also shows regional variation in its distribution. Cells in the outer zone behave and look like fibroblasts, whereas the inner zone cells look more like chondrocytes. When we consider the blood supply, there is good blood supply only to the outer one-third to two-thirds of the meniscus. They receive this blood supply from all three genicular arteries. The nerve supply, the outer zone and anterior and posterior horns are well innervated, and these nerve endings contain mechanoreceptors enabling the meniscus to detect proprioceptive information. When we consider the biomechanical properties of meniscus, the complex function of the meniscus are intricately related to their composition, structure, and morphology. Main function of the meniscus are load transmission, shock absorption, joint stability, joint lubrication, and proprioception. In addition to these functions, they also serve to reduce the contact stress on the articular cartilage and the subchondral bone, to increase the contact area, and also to improve the congruency of the knee joint because of their shape. The biomechanically, meniscal tissue shows viscoelastic properties mainly due to its extracellular matrix. Meniscal configuration adapts well to the shapes of the femoral and the femoral condyle and the tibial plateau. Due to normal loading, the meniscus is compressed by the downward force of the femur. The meniscus deforms radially, but it's anchored by its anterior and posterior horns, so they don't extrude. Instead, the compressive and the shear forces are converted to circumferential hoop stresses. This way, about half of the force transferred from the femur is dissipated in the meniscus without being transmitted to the tibial plateau, hence to the articular cartilage and the subchondral bone. Hoop stresses rely on the conversion of axial forces into the tensile strain through the circumferential collagen fibers of the meniscus. Of the radial and circumferential fibers, the circumferential fibers are mainly responsible to create these hoop stresses and to dissipate the force transmitted from the femur to the tibia. The biomechanical studies have shown that about 40 to 60% of the load acting on the extended knee is transmitted to the meniscus. In flexion, it can increase even up to 90% of the total load. Several studies have shown that load is well distributed when the meniscus is intact. However, removal of a meniscus results in a significant reduction in femoral condyle contact area and a marked increase in the contact stress. Several studies have reported that total lateral meniscectomy results in about a 40 to 50% reduction in the contact area and 200 to 300% increase in the contact stress in the lateral compartment. The increase in load per unit area contributes to the accelerated articular cartilage damage and degeneration, so hence eventually leading to development of osteoarthritis of the knee joint. One of the other important functions of the meniscus is shock absorption. The shock absorbing capacity of the meniscus has been demonstrated by studies measuring the vibrations in the proximal tibia resulting from gait. From this study, it has been shown that shock absorption is approximately 20% less in knees without meniscus. So the load transmission from femur to tibia is 20% higher in meniscectomized knees. This function of the meniscus is associated with its viscoelastic properties, and that is mainly controlled by its collagen elastin fibers and the water contained in the extracellular matrix. The main factor determining about function is the water content of the extracellular matrix. Therefore, on impact, the force is absorbed by the meniscal tissue due to the frictional drag forces created by the fluid escaping the tissue. The contribution of the meniscus to the stability of the knee joint. The incongruous articulation between the convex femoral condyle and the flat tibial plateau is ameliorated by the concave shape of the superior surface of the meniscus. The firm attachment of the medial meniscus to the tibia contributes to the anterior stability of the knee. The intact meniscus limits excess motion in all directions, contributing to the stability of the knee joint. The lubricating properties of the meniscus, which is very important in the knee joint movement to prevent any articular cartilage wear and tear. The meniscus may also play a role in the lubrication and nutrition of the knee joint. The precise mechanisms by which lubrication occurs remain unknown. Some authors believe that when the knee is loaded, the meniscus compresses and the circulate synovial fluid into the articular cartilage, reducing the frictional forces during weight bearing and providing joint nutrition. The meniscus may also serve as a proprioceptive role, as suggested by the presence of mechanoreceptors in the anterior and posterior horns of the meniscus. The quick adaptive mechanoreceptors, example, Pacinian corpuscles, are thought to mediate the sensation of the joint motion, while slow adapting receptors like Ruffini endings and also Golgi tendon organs are believed to mediate the sensation of the joint position. Probably these nerve endings are playing an important upfront role in the sensory feedback mechanisms of the lower limb. This being my presentation to an end, thank you very much for your attention.
Hi, Dr. Chindagvijaya sir. So thank you for your very elaborative presentation in meniscal anatomy. And we will keep the questions at the end, and we will move to the next presentation by Dr. Dilshan Munidas. Dr. Dilshan Munidas, he is a consultant orthopedic surgeon working in National Hospital of Sri Lanka in Colombo. He is a senior orthopedic surgeon mainly interested in arthroscopy, arthroplasty, and mainly in trauma also in our setup. And he does a lot of shoulder work as well as knee arthroscopic work. He will talk on the meniscus, when to repair and when not to repair. This is important because we have to identify which meniscus has to be repaired and which has to be removed. So Dr. Dilshan Munidas, it is over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I must thank Auto TV for giving us this opportunity to join with you in this Zoom meeting with our Indian colleagues, and a special thank to Dr. Sarnakuma who gave me this opportunity to talk on. I'm going to talk about meniscal injuries, whether you should salvage or sacrifice. Knee arthroscopy is one of the most commonly performed surgeries in most countries. And it has been found that meniscal injuries are found in most of these knee arthroscopy procedures, as well as MRI performed in older generations. It has been found that meniscal injuries are so common. I think this topic was very well elaborated by Dr. Chintagar. So I move on to the next slide. Before I move on, I must clarify a few terms, what is in zones of the meniscus to describe my future presentation. Inner zone is the red zone where the vascularity is the most, and then the partially vascular is the red-white zone, and the most inside the white-white zone is the one which is basically nutrition is supplement by the joint fluid. And also the meniscus injuries can be described according to the architecture, and there are vertical or longitudinal tears and the oblique tears, degenerative tears and transverse and horizontal according to the architecture of the meniscal injury. And also it can also be described according to the location of the anatomical location of the injury. If it happens in the root area, it is described as root lesion, and then it is happen in the meniscocapsular region, it is called meniscocapsular region. And Risberg injuries at the region of the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. And also there are special type of meniscal tear which are specifically associated with certain type of injury. One of those is called a ramp lesion, which is happening in the medial meniscus, and there is a specific injury pattern in this injury. And there is very commonly it is associated with ACL rupture, and notoriously it is well known for missing in MRI as well as arthroscopic surgeon weaving through anterior port. And due to the complexity of problem, some authors have described a method of describing a meniscus injury, combining two classifications, that is zone and region. There are four zones, like red-white zone, and starting from lateral to medial, and then and there is a region from starting from posterior horn of the medial meniscus, going clockwise, A, B, C, D, E, F. In this classification, if one is having, for example, in the lateral meniscus, in the mid region, somebody can describe it as E3 or 2 or 1, depending on the depth of tear that has gone radial. And there are other descriptive combination which is introduced by the Isakos. It is more elaborative description where it takes into consideration of the tear depth and location, radial location, and many, many facts. So that it can be very well described in because all these descriptions are important in the final decision of making whether to salvage or sacrifice. So what do we do when you have a meniscal tear, whether you operate or non-operate? So if you are non-operative, you go for conservative management. If you are not, if you are operating, it is either partial meniscectomy, total meniscectomy, repair or replace. So let us consider if it is repair or not. Generally, it is said the traumatic tear is more amenable for surgical repair. How do we identify traumatic injury? It happens in young patients, and it is there's a significant traumatic event, and no evidence of osteoarthritis, and there are particular tear patterns like vertical, bucket handle, and radial tears. If it is a non-operative decision, if you take it, things are very easy. Whether you do physical therapy, medication, steroid, then you apply supports and then start rehabilitation. So, but with this, you might sort of end up in sort of increase in the tear with becoming it's irreparable. What are the consequences of meniscus loss? Dr. Chintaka told us that there are the functions of a meniscus. If you lose the meniscus, what happens is articular cartilage is overloaded, then the biomechanical, there are biomechanical changes that happens in the articular surface and ultimately end up in osteoarthritis. Not only the meniscal injury, there are other factors also contribute to the progression of OA in meniscal injuries. They can be, if you incise a large portion, it's proportionately more chances of developing osteoarthritis. And if it is a partial resection of the lateral meniscus, more associated with development of osteoarthritis. Radial tears are notoriously producing taking them to osteoarthritis in later life. And pre-existing cartilage lesions, persistent ligament laxity and joint laxity, axial deviation, the deformities of the knee joint, obesity, age, and low activity all has been identified as progressive factors for the osteoarthritis in patients who have meniscal injuries. What happens? At the beginning, I told there are various things that you do it for the meniscus. One thing is you do total meniscectomy. This article has been very well cited by many presenters. It has been known that since ancient time, the loss of meniscus would result in osteoarthritis. It's a 14-year follow-up, and they have observed after 14 years there are osteoarthritic changes like femoral condyle ridge formation, femoral condyle flattening, and joint surface narrowing that can be observed in this this group of patients way back in 1948. Not only that, in there are certain other presentations in 21-year-old study. It has shown that meniscectomy would result in about 70% of even mild OA in their group, in comparison to control group, which has only 18%, which means about 3.5 times higher rate of developing osteoarthritis in the group who has undergone total meniscectomy. When you come to the partial meniscectomy, it is also not immune to the osteoarthritis. Even though in some studies shows that partial meniscectomy gives some relief to the patient immediately, fast pain relief and good subjective outcome, and early return to work. And the long-term outcomes shows that there are osteoarthritic changes happening in even partial meniscectomy. Then what are the indications for the total or partial meniscectomy? Generally, longitudinal or vertical tears in the white zone are notorious to non-healing because of poor blood supply. Horizontal tears happens in the degenerative menisci are traditionally sacrificed. Unstable tears like flap tear, radial tears are known to coined as equal to loss of meniscus. But the current situation is much different. And complex tears that happen in the degenerative meniscus, irreparable root tears, and failed attempt at meniscal repair. You cannot have so many attempt to do repair because that damages the meniscus. And certain situations of bucket handle tear, particularly if they are happening in the avascular area and the degenerative changes have already occurred, if they are inability to reduce, and if they are a deformed segment. So what situation we try to do meniscal repair? In situation like longitudinal tears in red zone is well known, and red-white zone is also amenable. And I think the what we do for the meniscal tears will be elaborated by our Indian faculty. And meniscal root tears are amenable to repairs with new techniques, and meniscal ramp lesions are also amenable to repair. When we go to literature, some things are confusing. If you see this study, it has a systemic review, and partial meniscectomy comparison compared to meniscal repair, it has shown that reoperative rate is much more in meniscal repair than partial meniscectomy. Then you might ask why you should do, why we do meniscectomy repair. But it has also been found that even though the results are there, the repairs had better long-term range of motion and their radiopic OA changes has very much less. And then same study, it has been found that lateral repairs has lower reoperation rate at the medial side and lower failure rate of, if we combine with the anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction. So when we when we look at the meniscus in arthroscopy, there are certain consideration we have to whether to salvage or sacrifice. We have to consider about whether they are degenerate or traumatic tear, and the duration, the classification I just described, and the zone, which zone it has occurred, and the surgeon's experience matter, availability of implants is the matter, associated injuries, and the activity level of the patient. Even though the traditionally it has been coined that certain injuries are meniscus is sacrificed, by improving techniques like rasping, refination, augmentation of fibrin, attending associated lesions, and good postoperative preparation would enhance the healing rate, and then certain irreparable repair can become reparable in current day practice. And there are multiple implants. I think other faculty would elaborate on this. And there are certain contraindications. If your knee is unstable, better not to repair. You can re-injure. And severe degenerative changes, not advisable. So taking into consideration those facts, what do we actually do with the tears? Generally, longitudinal tears, as I just said, red and red-white zone, repairable, we go home and we go and repair. And if it is less than 1 centimeter length, we can just leave them alone. And when it comes to radial tear, traditionally it was known to sort of equal to meniscectomy, so meniscectomy performed, but with current new techniques, it can be salvageable. And in root tears, repair is in acute. If acute situations, we can repair root tears. There are some logarithm of root repair. If first we have to see whether the surgical candidate, if it is yes, then you have to consider it is acute. If it is chronic, it may not be salvageable. And in acute situation, you see whether there is joint space narrowing. If there is no, then only you only select cases you can go for the for meniscal root repair. So in horizontal tears, generally white typically resection because it is considered as a degenerative tear. And in currently, it is certain authors have published it can be repairable in younger patient. And bucket handle tears repair whenever possible. Some thin white tears, obviously in the white zone, resection is advisable. And chronic degenerative tear resection is advisable. When you come to flap tears, it's generally resected in white area. It is repairable. And if most of the time it is sacrificed. Here is a small short video of a flap tear being excised. Some other surgeon would repair this. It extends into the red-white zone. And most of the time, this is an elite athlete, so I didn't want to take a chance, and there can be progression of the tear because of the tear pattern is almost extending to the red-white zone, and finally we shave it off, and that's the red-white zone. The remnant is shaved, and generally after shaving we look and see whether there are associated tears in the double tears, and most of the time such meniscal procedure is followed by secondary procedure like ACL reconstruction. In this case, it is stump preserving ACL reconstruction has been done. Then If you go to literature, what is the literature tell us about meniscal repair outcomes? And most of the studies have shown that all the meniscus repair, there is about 20 to 25% chance of meniscal failure in future. But if you combine with ACL reconstruction and some kind of stabilization procedure, the survival rate is, reoperation rate is very much less. The results of red zone is very well known, but there are certain studies that have studied what are the consequences of red white zone tear. There is a good chance of recovery, about 78% if you do it in around of 25 years. Therefore, it is advisable to go for repair in younger patient in red white zone. What about the clinical studies of the horizontal meniscal tear? Even though it is traditionally said it is can be excised as is a degenerative tear, but certain studies have shown that in if it is done in younger patient, there is a very good chance of repair. Overall success rate of about 77% in such patients. What about the root lesions? It is generally it is prognostic factor at minimum 5 years, and generally in this study, the systemic review of 172 patients, it has shown that the repair has brought OA changes, no progression changes up. More than 80% of the patients, and completing has been noted, and therefore in younger patients it is advisable for go for repair for root repair. When it comes to the decision making, it is still very confusing. We have to consider various facts that I just described. So many classification system has come, and we can only describe. When it comes to this, really the decision making, it is the surgeon's decision. Really speaking, I wonder whether there are in orthopedic surgery there are so many scoring systems in even the smallest thing, but such a commonly done procedure like meniscectomy or salvage, we still do not have a proper scoring system. I think it's practically difficult to produce. I think our eminent Indian faculty in future might sort of introduce us good, like ISACOS is a good platform to bring about a good meniscal decision-making platform. And in summary, I would I say the progression of osteoarthritis is inevitable after meniscal loss. So knowing the consequences, try salvage as much as possible. So even though repair increases reoperation rates, it reduces progression of osteoarthritis. Healing rate can be improved with advanced techniques available today. And salvage the meniscus as much as possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Dilshan, for your very elaborative discussion about when, whether to repair or not. So I will take up the next presentation by Dr. S.R. Sundararajan. He is not a new person for the whole India, and he's a head of the Department of Arthroscopy Unit in Ganga Hospital, Coimbatore, and he is a Joint Secretary of Indian Arthroscopy Society and also President-elect of Tamil Nadu Arthroscopy Society. And he also, well known in Sri Lanka also, incorporated with the Sri Lanka Orthopedic Association, he came twice to Sri Lanka, and he conducted workshops in arthroscopy in Sri Lanka also. I welcome Dr. Sundararajan to talk on the meniscal repair technique of all inside meniscal repair. Over to you, Dr. Sundararajan.
Thank you, Swarna Kumar, for the introduction. And I'm happy to share my presentation. I think that the previous presentation has to be unshared. He has to unshare his screen. Dilshan has to
unshare. Dilshan, you have to unshare this screen. We are good. All right.
Yeah, I think you're done.
Right, okay. So,
okay, good evening, everyone. And my topic is on only about talking technique of all inside meniscus repair. I think I'll start with a case of a 25 years old female. We had a two-wheeler accident and presented with the giving way of her knee joint. And that is her MRI. And as you see here, she had a complete ACL tear. And also you can see that meniscus and the lateral side in the posterior horn, which you could see there's some signal changes in the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. When you do an arthroscopy and you can see this is the typical vertical or longitudinal tear of the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. And when you put a probe and pull it inside, it is unstable. That means this patient needs a repair, and this is the all inside technique is an ideal solution for this problem. So all inside repair technique is not only suitable for posterior horn of the medial and lateral meniscus, and also it can be extended up to the body or the middle third of the meniscus, both on the medial and the lateral side. But basically we tend to use more on the posterior horn of the medial and the lateral meniscus. Yes, there is a possibility of using the traditional techniques can cause the neurovascular injury in the posterior structures. So the all inside is ideally indicated for the posterior horn of the medial and lateral meniscus. So it is introduced a decade ago. It is a very simple technique, and ease of the technique led to the popularity. It doesn't require an additional incision like what you do for an incisional inside-out technique, where you need to have a safe incisions on the medial and lateral side to prevent the neurovascular injury. Of course, it also has got a less operative time and less risk of neurovascular injury compared to the traditional technique. When you had our first generation devices, they came with very rigid instrumentations and the implants, and they were all made up of bioabsorbable materials. And they were designed with some barbs, heads, or sometimes they had a screw heads to engage the meniscal tissue. And the compression at the tear site is difficult to achieve and nearly impossible to adjust after the incision. That resulting in a lot of failures. And these are the names which you can name apart than the first generation all inside devices. And also the first generation devices leading on to the foreign body reaction because of the bioabsorb and a lot of loosening, and also because of that implant, and they did a lot of contral damage, resulting in forming these second generation fixation devices. They came with suture length between the two anchors, which is adjustable and allows compression, and comes in only one size with variable angle of the needle delivery system. And anchors deployed across the capsule cannot be removed arthroscopically once inserted. There are fast fix and rapid lock. I think many of us may know the names of these. When you come to the third generation devices, there are many devices available in the market where you have a Cinch 2, MaxFair, or FastFix 360. Even there are multiple implanted systems like from the CONMED. There are many companies has got all inside system. So this is a meniscal Cinch 2 from the Arthrex, where you can see that they have a very stiff needle with active implant flipping, which can come through, and smooth fiber wire sliding knot. And they have the reusable and disposable knot pusher with the suture cutter available. When you use the meniscal Cinch 2, or I think most of the implants, are the almost in the same category with the same mechanism with the slightly different operative techniques. As you see, this also has got the two independent operating handles for the two implants. Usually it comes with the two implants, and the both were made up of peak implant. And there comes with the pre-sliding knot, so we don't need to put any knot. And they have a very sharp and crimped cannula tip where the needle will go smoothly and come into the cannula in the same manner. That was the advantage and improved version from the Cinch 1. And they have the controlled positioning of the sheath, which will come here. So this is a demo video from this company where you can see this is the Cinch 2 technique where you have a two independent hand delivery system for the two implants. The first one, you can see already it is loaded off the way, and that is the numbered, and they are numbered is number one and number two for the number one implant and number two implant. And also they have the sleeve. It also acts as a sleeve, and also you can measure the meniscus length where you want to deliver it. Usually it varies from 12 to 18. As you see here, it has a mark. So that mark, which you want to have a 14, if you measured 14, you can keep it up over there and you can have the safe length you can penetrate so that you don't over penetrate the posterior horn of the meniscus and damage the neurovascular structure. Most often up to 18 mm is safe in the literature if you penetrate. If you do overdo, then the possibility you can injury the nerve or vessel. So when you do the first implant insertion, you do the first hand in that button, you go down, all the way down, and come all the way back and lock it, so that that will flip the first implant in, from the in the back of the meniscus. You can see here. So this, it has to go all the way back. Once you come through that, then you slowly withdraw it. Don't withdraw the same way which demonstrated in the video. Always you twist and make it slowly take it off, because sometimes the meniscus quality may not be the good one, or the tear may not have the good tear, complex tear, then that can withdraw the implant if you try to forcefully withdraw it. Then you try to offload that second hand locker so that it loads the implant. Then you introduce the needle within, whether you can do a vertical mattress or you can do the vertical stitch or you can do a mattress stitch. Here you are doing the mattress stitch. So you can see that again, this was locked all the way down, and again you brought back all the way back to lock it. Then you withdraw the needle. Then you use the knot pusher, which can go through that independent thread which was left alone outside. Then go and push the knot. The knot and pull that thread which is outside, so that slowly that knot which is in the second implant side, once the threads gets tightened, slowly will be shifted to the first implant. You can see that with gradually you just push the knot, keep it with the meniscus, and slowly withdraw this thread so that that will tighten the knot, and also it will flip and gives the tension to the mattress stitch which you are making. Make sure that you have adequate tension. Don't try to pull too hard, because it can pull off the implant sometimes inside, or it can cut through. So then once you've done the adjustable tensioning, then you cut off with the same thing can be used for the cutter. When you have a posterior horn of the meniscus, especially on the medial side, sometimes you can have a tight knee, like what you do in the root repair. So if you are very, very much struggling in entering the space in the posterior horn, like in the roots, root repair, don't hesitate to do a pike crusting. Otherwise, generally, if you have a 20 to 30 degrees of valgus with the external rotation, we'll have an adequate opening over there. But sometimes it is very tight. Use a 18 gauge needle from outside, from the femoral insertion of the MCL or the tibial side, make a multiple pricking, like what you do for a total knee replacement. And it gets an opening like this, is such a big opening, so that you are comfortable in doing your repair in the posterior horn, so that you don't damage your articular cartilage on the femoral side or the tibial side. So a pike crusting can be used. However, I don't use for meniscus posterior horn, very rare in young patients, usually because they'll have an ACL tear, you'll have a more opening, or even they have associated MCL tears. But if you have tight knee, you don't need to worry about it, doing a small pike crusting, so that you don't need to struggle. When you come to the lateral side, you do the figure of four position with the internal rotation. And also sometimes if you are very much not approachable, then you can put a downward pressure over the knee so that that will open the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. Here another tip is you cannot reach the posterior on the lateral meniscus through the anteromedial portal. So you have to switch the scope from to the anteromedial portal, and you have to use the regular anterolateral viewing portal as a working portal. So you have to switch the scope here to reach the posterior horn. This is very, very important. Make sure that you have an adequate perpendicular direction and trajectory for the particular tear. Otherwise, what happens that this meniscus implant can get bent, and the lumen, it can bend, lumen can break it, and it can fail to deploy the implant. So it's very important that you have adequate space, adequate trajectory, so that you can make an, even if you want to make an additional accessory portal, that is good enough, you should do it. And also it is very important to measure the length of the meniscus so that you don't over penetrate that meniscus, so that you don't need to worry about the neurovascular injury. You can see that the same patient, you can see that that is the same medical tear which we are talking about, very unstable posterior horn of the medial meniscus. Again, use the same all inside technique over here, the same device which I showed in demo. Here we measured up to the 14. So you also, they have a measurement in the length. So you don't need to worry about the sleeve. You can see the reading over there. So once you deployed the first implant, retrieve the needle, which you can see that I'm slowly twisting it and taking it off instead of pulling very hard, so that your meniscus, you don't damage the meniscus, and it won't come. Your sometimes implant can come through the hole which you make it. Then you take the off way down the second hand locker, and you again go all the way down. Once the needle penetrated completely, you can see that it has gone up to the 14 mm. Then once I deployed the implant, then again slowly I'm withdrawing it by slow twisting force. This is very, very essential when you do this kind of all inside technique. Then you use the knot pusher to make sure that you are holding the knot over there. You can see that it was shifted from the second implant to the first implant. Once you do the tightening, then you go with the same knot pusher, can cut the knot over there. So that is the final stable meniscus. And it is not limited to just a vertical or longitudinal tear. You can see this is a case of one posterior cruciate ligament tear with a medial condyle fracture. And also when you do an arthroscopy, this patient also had a complete radial tear of the meniscus, medial meniscus. You can see it's a completely through and through tear. Again, here I'm using an all inside. Here I'm using the Fosfix 360. Again, this all same system, because this helps you, especially when you have this kind of complete radial tear. When you use an all inside technique, you make a one on either side of the incision, bring that both completely torn meniscus into the approximation. So the all inside technique can be used for the a complete radial tear too here. However, for the complete radial tear, one stitch of all inside may not be sufficient. Here I am using the inside out techniques again. You can see that this is an one stitch which was done in the superior side. This is another all inside stitch, because there is a complete radial tear needs more stability. So you need at least 3 or 4 stitches along with your all inside to get complete stability, so that heals very well. So it's a fresh case, complete through and through tear, so that this has to be repaired. You can see that this was completely repaired instead of doing the total meniscectomy. As already mentioned by the other speaker, by doing a meniscectomy for the complete radial tear could be a subtotal meniscectomy. And it's another case, you can see the completely flipped meniscus in the posterior side here. Sometimes when you see the scope, sometimes we may wonder where is the meniscus. Is it completely absent over there, because it was flipped in the posterior side. So that can be reduced, and it can be brought back into the position here. And once you reduce that meniscus, then you do the all inside technique here. Here I'm, after reducing here, I'm using the cinch one, which was done a few years before, which has got, we can see that which was a broad cannula. Now the change into the very small crimp tip, so that it is easy to insert and withdraw it. So here we required 2 or 3 all inside implant. You can see that I'm using the second implant. and that was the complete repair after doing the all inside technique in the flipped meniscus. That is the final repair, that is the ACL reconstruction. Of course, in the bucket handle tear, in the posterior horn, you had to do the all inside technique. Before you do the all inside technique for the posterior horn, first you stabilize the middle third with your inside out technique. Then later on, once of doing the all inside technique, then you use the I think these techniques will be demonstrated by Atik, so I'm not going through that. Once you finished everything, or even before that, you can use the all inside technique for the posterior horn, which I'm using here. That is the all inside technique for the posterior horn in the lateral meniscus. So advantages of all inside repair, we have very, very shorter operating time compared to the inside out technique or outside in technique. No extra incisions required, and you don't need to have much assistance for like an inside out techniques, and accessibility to difficult locations. However, the complications which we talked about, sometimes over penetration of the needle can cause some aneurysm of the popliteal artery, or you can have the nerve injuries if you are not very careful. But very, very 2% neurovascular injuries is demonstrated in the literatures. You can have a problems in the implant deployment. Yes, I said, if you don't have an adequate space and position, and if you don't have a direct trajectory, then that can fail because the implants are very costly. So they had to be very careful in using these implants. Loss of fixations can happen if the quality of the meniscus is bad or the tear is very complex, where the tear extends up to the posterior side. Sometimes when you do an implant deployment and withdraw it, sometimes implant can come with it, which we had to aware of that, or inadequate tension can cause failures. How to rehabilitate this patient? I think when you do only an all-inside technique in the posterior horn, you can do an immediate knee mobilization. There is no problem in that. You can do a weight bearing and extension, so that will help to heal the meniscus. To conclude, all-inside is suitable for the posterior one third of the meniscus. Also, it can be extended to the body of the meniscus. With all the vertical or longitudinal tears, it can be used in complete radial tears or the bucket handle tears, and it is more precise, quick, and more stability with not security. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sundar Rajan. It's very, very demonstrative video, and we were able to understand how it's done all inside technique. See how it has changed the. A treatment modality in meniscal repair, all inside. Thank you again. And I will invite Dr. Atik Vasudev to talk on meniscal repair, inside out and outside in technique. Dr. Atik Vasudev is the director of knee unit in Medanta Hospital in India since 2009. He is well known in India and internationally, because he has published many articles and presentations, and he has contributed many chapters in books in arthroplasty and arthroscopy as well. And he is going to talk on meniscal repairs inside out and outside in. Over to you, Dr. Atik Vasudev.
Sorry, can my screen be seen?
Yeah, we can see. We can see well.
Thank you for that introduction. Thanks to Avana. Thanks to my colleagues from Sri Lanka and my colleagues here in India. Thanks for having me over. So I think we've had some lovely talks, and most of my topic seems to have been covered. But I'll speak about outside in and inside out meniscus repairs. We know about meniscectomy and increasing contact areas and forces leading to early osteoarthritis. well documented by Fairbanks way back in 1948. So today the concept we know is more of preserving the menisci. And if you look at this article, I think they've changed a bit of the classification now, that because the vascularity keeps off the menisci keeps changing as we grow older. And what the consensus here clearly said, that more and more menisci are getting repaired. So I think this is a very relevant webinar that we're having over here. Repair rules are usually injury less than 4 weeks. This is what I follow. Rims less than 4 millimeters. Patients usually 40 years or less. And I think no malalignment is a good thing to have. What is essential for meniscus repair is the ABC, anatomic reduction, biological preparation, and circumferential compression. You need to follow these. And I think the basic principles of whatever we do, whichever technique we use, is we must freshen the edges and give a solid fixation, whatever technique we are using. We know about the zones usually from anterior to posterior. So there are basically three techniques. If you come from anterior to posterior, outside in. In the middle would be inside out, and posteriorly, very beautifully covered by Sundar, is the all inside technique. So outside in repair indications are usually for the anterior thirds of the bucket handle tear. Discoid meniscus, again in the anterior thirds, or the mid two thirds also you can use. Sometimes I use them, and of course a meniscal transplant. The options available to us are the mini lassos, the single needle technique, and the two needle technique described by Laprad. It's a very simple technique, and I quite often follow that. The mini suture lasso, as provided by Arthrex, it's a good system for outside-in meniscal refixation. It has curved. It has a straight and a curved lasso. It's basically a hook. You're trying to pass a suture through that hook using a 2-0 fiber wire. It's quite thin, though the shaft is a little thick, 2.4 millimeter, but the tip is very thin. It's about 1.3 millimeter, and it has a wire loop through which you can pass the suture, as I'll show you. And if you look at it, it's basically trying to pass a suture through a loop. Sometimes it can be technically challenging initially, but once you get the hang of it, it's pretty easy. So if you look at the steps, you pass it in, you keep visualizing it, you have a loop, and then you try to pass a suture through that and pull it out. I'll skip this. So if you look at this, these are my own set. If you look at it, these are a straight and a curved lasso. So what you're trying to do is pass the curved into the straight, pass the suture through it, and pull the suture out. These are the four steps that you need to follow that. That's as simple as that. This is one of my videos. I think this was a patient with a large bucket handle tear whom I used all kinds of techniques. So he needed one inferiorly, and I used the two needle technique. So what I do is I pass two lassos out of the portal, and then pull my suture through that and just tie the knot outside. I think it's a very easy way to do it, and it's very simple. So that was something about the outside in, and now we'll just come to the inside out meniscal repair. It's the preferred technique quite often. It's used to be the gold standard. It has very low profile needles. Needles can be accurately placed with high strength, and you can anatomically reduce all kinds of tears. So it's pretty versatile and flexible. But the main challenge here is that you need a number of assistants, and you need to give an incision. Also, the inside-out repair techniques offer a success rate of 60 to 80% for isolated meniscus repair, and it goes up when you have a concomitant ACL reconstruction. So what are the options available? I think you need to know the option. One is the suture tape, which is available now. I've been using the suture tape for 0.9 suture tape far more frequently. The cutout rates are less as compared to the 2-0 fiber wires. Then we have the zone navigator. I'll tell you about it. And of course, then you have the suture protection system, the needle protection system, which works pretty well. So coming to the mini suture tape with the meniscus repair needle, it's a 0.9 mini suture tape. It lies flat on the meniscus and distributes force more evenly. And it's attached to a 1.1 millimeter diameter needles. It's supposed to have more tissue resistance to tissue pullout as compared to the number 2 or the 2-0. Knots are supposed to be better, and it can be used with both the protection system and zone navigator. The protective meniscus suturing set is an inside out, all inside meniscus suturing. It has a single curved cannula with a plastic handle. It has a bending tool. You can actually, if you look at the thing here, you can actually bend the cannula to your convenience so that you can pass the wire to wherever you want. The new thing in the market today is the zone navigator. It's basically for the inside out technique. It has an acmeal cannulas for the anterior, posterior, and the middle zone. I am a bit skeptical about using it in the posterior. I think, as Sundar said, the all inside is a much better option for the posterior. I'm far more comfortable with that, and it allows all types of horizontal or vertical constructs. So this is a video from Arthrex itself. I'll just play that quickly, so you can see that. So there's a device. You can attach your wherever you want to use it. You can attach it according to that. You can pass your needle. Basically, what it allows you is to push the needle with that thing. You can just push the needle like this. If you look at that, you can either go front, back. You're versatile. You can pull. If you're not comfortable, you can pull it back, go forward, pull back, and you can go to whichever zone you want. So it just makes your life a little. You can see that going forward here, and then you can come back with it. It's pretty decent, and it's quite comfortable to use. What is important, like Sundar mentioned very clearly, is that you need to create space according to where you are. What you can't see, you can't repair. So this is how I do it. I do my arthroscoping sitting down and in extension, and my tendency is used more to use this 18 gauge needle more towards the femoral insertion. I'm more comfortable because I feel the healing is better there than maybe in the tibia or in the mid part of the joint. So I do that, and it's pretty good. So this is one of my videos. I'll just show you quickly. So this was in the junction and almost near the posterior part. I think we could have gone to an all inside here also, but I think it was more for economical reasons that I used the inside out technique, and it was pretty. I was pretty comfortable with that. So. I use both sometimes vertical and mattress sutures wherever, however it comes. But I think in the posterior part, you should use the all inside. So another video. So this is a large bucket handle tear. The young guy, I done an ACL in him earlier, right going from the posterior to right across to the anterior. I think I use all kinds of techniques here. To the inside out, the outside in, and the all inside here. So you need to freshen the edges. I think that's very, very important. After you reduce it, you need to really, this is a neat little diamond rasp where you can really freshen the edges here. And you can probably augment this with a fibrin clot or a PRP or whatever you're comfortable with. I freshened it nicely. Then I passed sutures. I used, I think, 10 sutures here. Let me show you the final thing. See that, and I used this is an inferior outside in suture which I used. So two needles, you can see. Then I passed the lassos out, and then I pulled both my two ends of the suture, so it just makes it easy, and that is the final result. The guy, fortunately for me, did pretty well. So another video. Reduce it. I use an outside in more anteriorly, and then an inside out. And if pull out the suture, but you need to. You can either make the incision before or later. Nowadays, my tendency is to make it later, but I think making the incision is better. This is courtesy my friend Sheetal. He's given me this video of a healed meniscal repair. I think it looks really nice. It was worth all the effort. So I think the key here is to pass sutures. You need to, initially, it'll be easier for you to pass the needle in 20 degrees of flexion and advance it to a centimeter or so and gradually flex the knee and so that you can advance your needle nicely. Sutures should be tied in 90 degrees of flexion. You should be cautious not to over-tighten the tissue or entrap the tissues nearby. The incisions for the medial meniscus, a vertical incision, is usually made posterior to the medial collateral ligament. It's the interval between the head of the gastrocnemius and direct arm of the sembrinus, so that's a safe area. And for the lateral meniscus, it should be made along the inferior aspect of the IT band between the lateral gastrocnemius tendon and the posterior lateral capsule proximate to the biceps femoris. That's the safe region. You can pass your needles quite neatly over there. Possible complications include saphenous nerve injury, common peroneal nerve injury. Popliteal vessels can get injured, so incisions, I think, should be made earlier. Flexion contracture after suturing, deep vein thrombosis. I have seen in two of my patients, so all my meniscal repairs today get prophylaxis. And of course, needles stick injury to you and to your systems. In summary, placements of sutures should begin through the unstable portion of the meniscus, as Sundar mentioned. If you pass that, you can actually sometimes, if you're not able to reduce it, I've noticed that you can pass your sutures there and pull it, and you can, you're sometimes able to reduce the meniscus, especially with a entrapped bucket handle. And you should place sutures both in the superior and the inferior aspect, so there's no lifting off of the meniscus. Distance should be about 3 to 5 millimeters between each sutures. As many sutures as necessary are needed to stabilize the tear. You can get an anatomical reduction. Constructs are strong here. Meniscal damage is far less as you have smaller solid needle. You can repair all types of needles, all types of tears. That's pretty versatile. It's pretty become a little easier with the zone navigator now. I think these are articles which support the inside-out repairs, and they found that the results were at par with the outside, the all inside. So these are articles from 2016 to 2019 and with very good clinical outcomes. I think this is one article which should help everybody and written by, very proudly to say, written by our Indian authors, Himanshu Kataria and group, where they've done MRI studies to find out the risk of injury to your popliteal vessels, both in the medial lateral side. Of the inside inside out technique. I think it's a beautiful article and to read, and it's definitely worth it. I think another article which came out in 2017 is worth reading is our current conscientious views about meniscal repairs. It does change your outlook going through this. I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Vasudev, for your very good presentation regarding inside out and outside in technique.
And we have to go very fast because of lack of time.
Yes, I would like to invite Dr. Nilesh Kamath for our final presentation in this webinar. And Dr. Nilesh will talk on Ramdish and Ripia techniques. And Dr. Nilesh is a consultant and unit head of shoulder services in Sanchetti and Jahagir and KM Hospital in Pune. And he is a well-known faculty. He is a course instructor in many courses around India. And also he has contributed in international faculty as well. And he is involved in many cadaveric training programs as well. I invite Dr. Nilesh Kamath for your presentation. Over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Swarnakumar, for the kind introduction. let me also thank the organizers for the invitation for this meeting. And with that, I'll dive straight into my talk. So I'll be discussing, is my screen visible?
Yes, we can. We can see.
Right. So today I'll be discussing about the repair technique for a meniscal ramp lesion. This is where I work in the private healthcare sector in the city of Pune, which is 120 kilometers from Mumbai. And as I said, we'll be discussing about meniscal ramp lesions. So what are meniscal ramp lesions? Well, these are tears which are longitudinal tears along the meniscocapsular and meniscosynovial junction along the posterior aspect of the medial meniscus. They were first described by Hamburg in 1980s, but he described it as a capsular injury. It was Strobel who used the term ramp for these meniscal lesions. It was only in late 2000s early 2000s that Fengguo and Bertrand Connery-Sautet actually brought back the interest in meniscal ramp lesions. So why are they important? So if you look at the work of Phil Nere, he has shown that the posterior aspect of the meniscus, that is your posterior medial aspect, is important for rotatory stability. So if there is progressive detachment and that leads to a derangement of the meniscotibial ligament, which causes a posterior medial rotatory instability. So likewise, if you're looking at the meniscotibial ligament, that is the meniscotibial ligament, which is beyond the meniscocapsular junction. As opposed to that, a classical ramp lesion is along the meniscus and the capsule out here. So first thing to repair is you would want to visualize the ramp lesion. We very well know that these lesions are also known as the hidden lesions. So there are three ways how you can visualize this. Either you can do a transcondylar or a transseptal portal and try to assess visualization, or you can do a transnotch view, or you can effectively use a 70 degree scope. So we'll run through each one of this to visualize this. The anterolateral viewing is probably the most standard way of viewing this, wherein you would insert the scope. Somehow my video is not. Can you see the video playing?
No, it's now it's playing.
Okay, I'm going to go back and let me see if this plays again. Right, so that's the anterolateral viewing where you will insert your scope between the medial femoral condyle under the PCL and reach behind the medial femoral condyle and then flip your light source to see the back of the medial femoral condyle, and you should be able to see the capsulomeniscal junction. And this is where you'll try to identify for the so-called ramp lesion. When you're trying to go the transcondylar view, this is also the transseptal where you're going to create a window between the ACL and the PCL. And through this visualization or through this window, you will go in ahead and try to visualize this, the posterior medial aspect of the femoral condyle. As mentioned earlier, it was described as the hidden lesion of the posterior horn, and wherein anterior visualization can show only probably 60% of the tears. The posterior visualization via the anterolateral portal, another 23.2% of the tears, but it is the stage three, that means where you actually put in a spinal needle and probe the posterior capsule through the posterior medial portal, where these residual 16.8% of the hidden lesions are seen. So this is a schematic view that it means if you're using a 30 degree scope and going through the anterolateral portal, this is how your posterior medial aspect would look like. The same thing is exaggerated when you're using a 70 degree scope. This is of course only from a presentation perspective that we have these images. I do not routinely use a 70 degree scope when it comes to knee arthroscopy. We are all quite happy with the 30 degree scope. Likewise, through the transcondylar viewing, again, the image on the left shows a 30 degree scope showing visualization and trying to assess the posterior medial aspect. And you can see in the same patient, when you're using a 70 degree scope, you can visualize the tear much better. Now, what is important in remembering when you're doing these repairs is that the tear might not stay at the same level. The capsule tends to fall downwards, and it's very important to identify that and to lift up the capsule. The classification system has been given by Bertrand Sonnery-Cottet and his colleagues, wherein there are five grades of classification, wherein it's a progressive spectrum. Commonly what is seen is the type 3, where in addition to the inferior aspect of the meniscus, you have the meniscotibial junction, which is disrupted. In type 4, in addition to this meniscotibial disruption, you have another tear anterior to it, as seen in type 5, where there is a double tear which can be visualized. Feng Hua has shown that repairable lesions, these are all repairable lesions, and it's important to see them or identify them because they happen to have been in association with an ACL and more so in the younger age group. So here's a case example of the repair technique. A 28-year-old young male with an ACL deficient knee had a re-injury, presently has an ACL with PCL. These are his MRI findings. And on the sagittal screen, you can see that there is a signal which is there beyond the body of the meniscus. And this hyperintense signal should make you feel suspicious that you may be looking at a ramp tear. Also on the axial cut, you can see that there is a hyperintense signal which is seen right along the posterior capsulomeniscal junction, which should again make you aware that you may be looking at a ramp tear. When do you have a high degree of suspicion? If you look at your sagittal images very closely, sometimes you actually see a posteromedial bone bruise. That is suggestive of an injury to the capsule out there, and this may be associated with the ramp lesion. So this is a short video wherein we are doing or operating a left-sided ACL deficient knee. So here you can see on probing of the medial compartment, you can see a small tear on the posterior aspect. Now, under normal circumstances, you may think that it's a standard longitudinal tear, but viewing through the anterolateral portal, through the posteromedial aspect, you can see that it's a big ramp lesion on the posterior aspect of the medial meniscus along its posterior horn. You would create a posteromedial portal, insert a cannula, and then probe this tear, and you'll realize that it's a big rent, and that's where the entire capsule has fallen down. This is where you would come in with one of the suture lassos. I prefer to use the 45 degree suture lasso. It allows me to take a bite. It's important to take a bite of the capsular leaf first, then try to assess where would you want to take the bite of the meniscus. Sorry, I'm just going to go back to that. Right, so that's the bite through the capsular portion. Then you come towards the meniscus. In such a large tear, the first bite can be kept posterior to the body. That means you're approximating only the capsule out here. You then use the HD loop to pass across through this lasso. This loop is then retrieved through your anteromedial portal, and a 2-0 fiber wire is shuttled across through this lasso loop. Using a suture retriever, the free limb of the 2-0 fiber wire is then retrieved, and then using your standard shoulder sliding knots, or you can use multiple half hitches, and then this tear is repaired. A one single stitch is usually not sufficient, and you may have to take multiple stitches, more so through the body of the meniscus, and in a sequential manner, you would go ahead and repair the same. Now the same tear, when you're probing from the medial aspect, you can see that it fails to come further into the joint. So what are the pearls and pitfalls when you're doing a ramp repair? The most important thing is that visualization of these tears are extremely important. If you are unable to go through the anterolateral portal and visualize the back of the knee, it's worthwhile to do a direct transnotch visualization of the posteromedial compartment, or in some cases, it might be worthwhile, instead of creating a conventional portal, you might just use a spinal needle to probe the capsule from behind to see whether there is a tear along the posteromedial aspect. As far as suture management is concerned, multiple sutures are required depending on the length of the tear, The end result, as all the previous speakers have spoken, should be a secure and a stable repair rather than one single stitch. The flip side is that we're visualizing the posterior horn of the medial meniscus only from the anterior compartment, you may clearly miss a meniscosynovial or a meniscocapsular tear. And when it comes to suture management, well, those who are used to using shoulder arthroscopy, they are comfortable doing multiple suture management, but try to avoid tangling of the sutures. So pass one bite, tie it down, and then go on to the second bite rather than doing multiple sutures together. Thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Nilesh Kamath. And it has given the, actually we started with the programs and ultimately we have come to the final difficult approach, that's the ram lesion repair. As Dr. Kamath said, unless you look for it, you can easily miss it. So you have to look for it. So now we will open this for discussion. We can invite questions from anyone. You can quote our speakers and ask for questions. And first, shall I ask first question from so all faculties? How soon are you select to repair this meniscus if you won't repair? What's the earliest time frame you have given for these patients for repair?
Okay, can I take the question?
Yes, please.
Okay, Sunakumar, I think the duration, of course, the earlier is the better. If you do an acute or subacute cases, naturally you have a good early repair, gives you more blood supply and gives healing better. But however, the later on which we try to form, we found that the quality of the tissue is very, very important, and type of the tear and where it is torn, the location is very, very important, which it was shown by Dilzan in his presentation. So of course, in most of the cases which we do, of cases are mostly with the anterior cruciate ligament tear or with the posterior cruciate ligament tear or in the multi-ligament injuries, you always tend to do within the 2 weeks time or a 3 weeks time or 4 weeks time. So they are the ideal time to do the repair. But sometimes still you tend to get some few months, 4 months or 5 months. Sometimes you see a big bacchandial tear in a young patient, like 18 years or 20 years, you don't want to leave that meniscus and do a subtotal meniscectomy. So in this case, if the tissue quality, most of the time it will be very good, even if it is 6 months or 8 months, still we tend to do all the preparation, try to do a repair. In a young patient, it's very, very, very important. The only the tissue, quality of the tissue is determined. So suppose the bucket handle tear is not reducible, or the tissue quality is completely, if the tissue is completely rolled out, then that is the poor quality of the meniscus, which we cannot do a repair because we know that the chance of failure is very high. So in that case, you should have no other option. We should do a partial meniscectomy. Otherwise, we try to preserve the meniscus as far as possible, depending upon the type of the tear and the location rather than the time.
Can I add in a comment here?
Yes, sir. Yes,
yes, yes, please.
Yeah, so I think in clinical practice, two different scenarios. One is with a concomitant ACL reconstruction, and other is standalone meniscal tears. All of us would agree that when it comes to a concomitant ACL reconstruction, literature has shown that the healing rates are fantastic. So even if it's a slightly delayed presentation and a young patient, I would probably take in the entire effort to go in and try to do a repair as much as possible rather than doing a meniscectomy, a partial meniscectomy. Yeah. Now, when it comes to an isolated meniscal tear, routinely I add some augmentation procedure, either a microfracture, or I would do a trephination, or in a big tear, in a bucket tear, I might do a fine clot as well and incorporate that into the repair. When a patient presents to the clinic with an acute tear, I tend to wait for them for a period of 4 weeks, because many times the joint line tenderness actually goes down and every painful joint line might not require a meniscal repair even if an MRI shows so. But if it's a big tear, then there's no question about waiting. Then probably we might offer them a repair at the earliest, because as Dr. Sundar sir said, that earlier you do them, the better your outcome, rather than waiting for it to progress and to become a classical bucket handle tear.
I think all of us agree that we are trying to repair more and more. And I think as far as, like Sundar said, as far as probably the tissue is not plasticized, you know, you get that yellowish and that bad kind of thing. I think the tendency to repair, especially like Nilesh said, that with the ACL reconstruction is much higher. And I think our number of repairs are increasing. If I'm not, would you all agree? I think the number of repairs over the last couple of years has increased tremendously.
Yes, because we
extended the indications.
Absolutely.
Repair only for the vertical and longitudinal tear. Of course, maybe the 7-8 years before all that, I mean 5-6 years before even also, even the complete radial tear, we used to do a partial vasectomy. And now we know that even in the horizontal tears, it has shown that with the very good results of healing. So we try to do a repair as much as possible if the tissue quality is good.
I think age, I don't know, do I say less than 40? I don't think age is such a criteria now. If you have a pretty decent knee and the meniscus tissue looks good, I think probably I would repair that also. If there's no malalignment as such, I think I will go ahead and repair that.
Yeah, I think the physiological age is very, very important because not like before, now if you are over 45, you do a partial meniscectomy. That concept has gone. Like everybody is active nowadays. I mean, everybody wants to do some sport activity, physically active. They want to preserve the knee. So I think age is not a...
I think from age perspective, one of the major changes that has taken place over the last few years is management of these degenerate horizontal cleavage tears. So earlier, all of us would think that they are not painful. You can leave them the way it is, or either excise the thinner leaf. But now we know that contact stresses do increase even if we take out one leaf, and these tears tend to progress. So putting in these compression stitches without any anchors, using just a knee scorpion, is a good enough technique to close the mouth of these cleavage tears and prevent the progression. I think we have all been doing meniscal repairs, but the latest trend or the most recent change, I think, is the management of these cleavage tears, which all of us would like to kind of be aggressive about treating them.
Even the ESCA consensus has mentioned that we are preparing more and more much older tears, and especially the horizontal tears. More and more repairs have been done in that now.
And also, one more point, regarding the root tears. Maybe the root tears was not covered in our webinar. That is one of the most important development has taken place in the last 7-8 years. So when we talk about root tear, we don't talk just about only degenerative root tear. We also know that the root tear can happen in acute situations with ACL injuries. I think all of us should be aware that lateral meniscal root tears are more common with ACL injuries. We know that degenerative root tear is more common in the medial side. At the same time, the lateral meniscal root tears are common with the ACL. At the same time, even today I operated a case with an 18-year-old girl with the ACL tear, with the medial meniscus root tear. It's a one-year-old injury. Actually, no frontal damages, but there is a meniscus. And also, this patient got some laxity. So, I had to do an ACL reconstruction, do a medial meniscus root repair, and of course, ALL tenodiasis. So we should know about not ACL is not ACL alone. When you talk about meniscus, it's not just an application. The root lesions are very, very important.
Do you have any other questions from other audience coordinators? You can.
And maybe I can talk about, Nilesh talk, because it was a very interesting and a very useful talk about the ramp tear.
Yes.
I think, as he said, that even though it was talked about long back, in the last few years, it again climbing and now it coming in a big way. I think all of us should look for the ramification. Initially, even I used to think, because I used to do a lot of numbers, but I never look for a ramification. Not very long. Now when I see, that the percentage which we see in the literature, around 10% to 15% of ACL patients has got a ramp lesions. As he showed in that video, that kind of meniscal capsular lesion with unstable lesions, I think we tend to miss long, before. Now we tend to do a repair. So I think the recent advances is one of the thing is the ramp lesion we should look for all the time. We should keep the knee in 90 degrees, do an internal rotation, pass the scope through the space in the medial side between the medial condyle and the ACL and look for the ramp lesion. I think that is one of the recent advances we tend to follow now.
Being considered as one of the causes of ACL failures, if yes. It's not repaired.
Any other questions from
Dilshan? You need to unmute.
May I ask a question from Sundar?
Yes, Dilshan.
would you, two questions. One thing is, would you routinely do bicuspid in difficult situations? And if you do bicuspid, would you change your post-op protocol? And what do you do for difficulties in accessing on the lateral side?
Yes. Okay. For the bicrusting for the medial side, I tend to do almost for more than 90% of the cases for all my root lesions. And also the radial tear, which is very close to the root attachment, which we tend to get in privileged patients at the part of I tend to repair. So in all these cases, the knee will be very tight. Usually the females, they'll have a very tight knee. So I tend to do a bicrusting. But most of the traumatic situations in the young patients, when they are associated with the anterior cruciate ligament injuries, most often I never had any issue in opening even the posterior horn of the middle meniscus. So I very rarely I require to do a bicrusting for my meniscus repair. However, when there is a bucket handle tear like what Atik showed, we should not hesitate if you are trying to find this, struggling in reaching that posterior horn or the posterior medial junction, there is nothing wrong in doing the bicrusting. The only thing is we have to be very careful that you don't do an excessive bicrusting, make it more laxity on the medial side. Whatever necessary, because you are going to see under your vision, are going to do a bicrusting. So once you have enough space, you stop that bicrusting, then you can go on do that bicrusting. Especially in the lateral side, usually I never had any issues on the posterior horn. But only thing is sometimes when you have a tight knee, as I said, I do a figure of four position, do an internal rotation. I'll ask my assistant to the knee pressure, pushing the knee down and you keeping the leg in a more elevated position. So that will open up more on the lateral space in the posterior horn.
And you change the post-op protocol in bicuspid?
No, I don't do, because I do most of the cases are in my root lesions. Most of the cases they're all bit varus knees. So when you do on my mild bicrusting by opening up, it doesn't make any valgus laxity. So I never seen any patients with valgus laxity. So I don't open up too much also. And many patients, you do always do a high tibial osteotomy. Sometimes these patients have a varus osteotomy, where these patients always you do a posterior medial release for your medial open with osteotomy. So in that cases, I don't even do a bicrusting. So go on, just open the medial incision. I release the superficial MCL, then I'll come back and do the root repair. Then I go back and do the osteotomy. So you don't need to do a bicrusting in that cases.
Thank you.
I think just a comment about bicrusting is that, I use bicrusting very frequently. In fact, even if I feel that I have good visualization, I do bicrusting because it allows me to go on the superior surface as well as the inferior surface of the meniscus, which allows the stacking of the meniscus rather than it being lifted up or to prevent any chondral injury. The only comment that I have here is that do not let your assistant give the valgus force when you're doing bicrusting. You have to keep the heel of the valgus fors against the post. It engages spinal needle along the femoral side or at the level of the joint. Try to go and not completely transect, but as you hit the superficial MCL and have a horizontal movement, you will actually feel that those fibers giving way. And that's good enough. Literature has even shown that even if you transect the superficial MCL, there is going to be no valgus instability and they tend to heal well. The only thing you need to be aware about is be mentally ready to tell the patient beforehand that he'll have some medial-sided pain for a period of around 6 to 8 weeks, because that's something which is troublesome for them. And I try to do it above the joint line, which allows me to determine that it's not the pain which is coming in from the meniscus itself. So that is a pearl that I would think about when I'm doing pie crusting. But yes, routinely I would do pie crusting for my medial meniscus tears.
I agree, Nidesh, with you. I also do a lot of pie crusting, and I do it at its femoral attachment. And as you saw in my video, I was manipulating the leg myself. You can't allow someone else to manipulate the leg, because it's definitely going to cause a problem.
So one more question. I think it may be the last question. I think we have to wind up. We are behind the schedule. So do you use any PRP or any other materials to stimulate healing of this meniscus? There are PRP paste and there are different materials are available commercially. Do you all use for facilitating meniscal healing?
I use PRP because my hospital just makes it for me. And of course, you can do your marrow venting procedures like Nilesh showed. You can do that with ACL. It's an automatic marrow venting. Rasping is very important. So you can just combine a lot of this. Somehow I don't have very good experience with the fibrin clot. I've just not been able to get it correct.
But I use, in addition to what Atik said, is I do use fibrin clot when it comes to isolated bucket handle tears. With an ACL, I don't really do any augmentation procedure, because like he mentioned that you're opening up the marrow vents and it is going to cause, I don't keep a drain after my ACL. So whatever marrow has to fall back is going to be intra-articular and going to create a good environment. But when it comes to an isolated bucket tear, there are two things that I do. One is marrow vents in the intercondylar notch, that is beyond the attachment of the ACL. If I'm doing a lateral meniscus repair, I'll do marrow vents in the lateral gutter so that the marrow happens to be localized more out there. Although it's a potential space, it's going to move around. Likewise, isolated medial side, I would probably be doing marrow vents on the medial aspect. The challenge with fibrin clot is, number one, in preparation, unfortunately, we don't have any of the instruments which are glass instruments. Because glass has good static electricity and you have to keep stirring it for a good 15 minutes, we have specific test tubes which are used in the lab, which we have kept it ready in our operation theater setups, which are used to create the fibrin labs. That's one thing. Second thing is, after the fibrin clot is done, the challenge is, how do you deliver this inside the joint and to keep it there? One of the things which is helpful is we use meniscal suturing repair devices. We used to get these disposable cannulas along with them, which allow to insert the fibrin clot. So we plasma sterilize them, and that's something which allows us to deliver the clot. Having said that, it sounds easier than it is actually it. Because the clot tends to keep floating around. But once you're able to get it in between the meniscus and the capsule, and then I would preferably do an inside-out repair, because that clasps it out there, that holds it out there, and I'm not really then too bothered. Even one fibrin clot or two fibrin clots is great. It allows, at least on paper, it makes you feel more secure and comfortable that it's going to allow healing.
Along with the anterior cruciate ligament tear, I mean, actually, I don't use any of those. Even for the isolated tears, I do the marrow venting, which Atik and Nilesh talked about. and fibrin clot or PRP, which we don't use. We don't use any PRP because our institution doesn't approve the PRP. We are against PRP. I think all of us also should agree and understand that for the meniscal healing, what is more important is the correct indication to choose the patient, or stability of the meniscus which you are going to do it, and the location of the meniscus which you are going to repair, and how acutely you are going to repair, which helps you to healing the meniscus. Anyway, of course, these are additional biologists, definitely may help, but it's not a must. I think we should keep it also in mind.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Okay, in the absence of any comments and questions, I think we are in the final stage of our webinar. We are to come to the end now. First, I will thank all of our faculties, Dr. Dilshan Muridas, Dr. Chindaka Vijayadas, Dr. Sundararajan, Dr. Nilesh Kamat, and Dr. Vasudev. Thank you for your contribution, and in your tight schedule, you have done a very, very good presentation, and it has made so much of eye-opening regarding meniscal repair. Now we are walking forward. And in the meantime, I have to thank, on behalf of Sri Lanka Orthopedic Association, all the faculty and all the organizers, that is Avana and also Ortho TV, for giving this opportunity, for giving this webinar in the Indian and Sri Lankan forum. And the people behind this scene, I have to thank Ruchir and Sundar from Avana, and also Shan Hassan from Ortho Lanka Sri Lanka, for organizing this event and communicating with each of us to bring under one umbrella. And thank you very much again for your participation. And we would conclude this webinar with this event successfully. And I thank you again for your valuable contribution in this function on behalf of Orthopedic Association of Sri Lanka. Thank you again.
Thank you, Swarna Kumar. I think we are also happy to have a take part along with the Sri Lankan counterparts. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you again. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
students and as far as we